हेलो ऑल, गुड आफ्टरनून।
गुड आफ्टरनून टेलिंग मैम।
हाउ आर यू ऑल?
फाइन मैम।
हाउ इज इट गोइंग? एंजॉयिंग योर टाइम?
यस मैम।
ग्रेट
सर। सर इज नॉट, इट्स नॉट सर, इट्स मैम।
गुड आफ्टरनून। गुड मॉर्निंग मैम।
यस आई लॉक्ड इन।
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
How are you, ma'am?
I'm good. How are you all?
We are also good.
Enjoying your vacation.
Good morning, ma'am. Swar here.
Good afternoon.
Holiday. Are you enjoying your vacation? Holiday.
My vacations.
No, your holiday.
What holiday?
Today holiday.
Today, yes, you can count it as a holiday. Today the session is planned for your mama and papa as well. So if they are not there with you, please call them. Manish sir will join in soon. Okay?
Ma'am, I'm a... Arnav Kirkar and I'm actually at Mumbai. So my mom and dad are at Pune. I'm alone here.
Oh, so you can attend and brief them later what happened in the session. All right.
I'll just stay here.
So this is grade 4 to 7 all together.
Hey, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon,
sir. Children, I need to speak to your parents. Go call your parents.
Good afternoon, sir.
Children, call your parents, all of you. Come on, quickly.
Sir, I'm at Mumbai. My parents are not here.
So ask your parents to join. Where are your parents?
They're at Pune.
So tell them to join, no?
Because I'm alone here, so how would I tell them?
Huh?
You can call them, message
you can
them.
Call them. Call okay. them and tell them to join the meeting. Go on quickly. Come on, okay. Come on quickly. Tanay, call your parents. Come on, Ritik. Swar.
Yes, sir, I call my parents.
Yes, all of you call your parents. Come on quickly.
Sir, I'm calling my parents. He is coming.
Yes, yes. Hello everyone. I hope you have all the parents coming in.
I've made you the co-host, so it will be easy for you to share.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Yeah, are we expecting more students, ma'am? There are very few here.
Yes, there should be more.
Hi, sir.
You can wait for 2 to 3 minutes and then.
Yeah, we'll wait for a couple of minutes for the children. Yeah. Hi. Who's that, Ria? Your brother? What's his name?
Yes.
What's his name?
Shiva.
Shiva. Hi, Shiva.
Shiva.
How are you, Shiva? How are you? Ah, I love your smile. Superb. Hi.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, all of you. Ranveer, Ritvik, Arnav, Anay. Trisha, Avni.
Morning, sir.
Good morning. Sorry, afternoon now, ma'am. Corona has spoiled the clock for everyone.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon. How is Kushali?
Good afternoon, sir.
Chitransh, good afternoon all of you. Anaya, Viraj, Tanay, Shagvi.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, all of you. Yeah, we still
good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon. Now, could you please message the other parents to join?
Yes, I was just messaging on the group.
Okay. How's Reed, ma'am?
This one here. Excuse me?
Yes, bacha.
So actually my mother and father wanted to join the session, but actually they have a connectivity issue.
Where are they? So you are connected and they can't connect. How is that?
Ma'am, sirs were here.
Yes, sir.
Sir, my parents actually they are gone somewhere, so they have wanted to connect to the session.
That's fine.
They have a connectivity issue, so they can't connect.
Correct. That's okay. So, Khushali, where are your parents? Come on. Anya, don't go with your parents.
My father is sitting. My mom is coming to you.
Yes, yes. Quickly call them. Come on, all of you. Duvansh, how are you?
Good.
You're good. I know you're good, but how are you?
I'm fine.
Yeah, thank you. Good afternoon, Kavya, Rishita, Yana. How are you,
good
Yana?
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, Rishita.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, Ekansh.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, Divya.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, all of you. Come on, if the parents are, we can start, children.
So, I think we can start so that we can commence it at time. Otherwise, it will be too late.
Yeah, so I'll just start it off. Right, yeah. So
can we start?
Yes.
So let's understand the purpose of the spell bee. Yeah. Children, please keep yourself muted. If you have a question, I'll give you time to ask them. Yeah. If there's more than one people speaking, okay, we can't understand and we'll waste a lot of time. So keep yourself muted. If you have a question, write it down. I'll give you time to answer, ask your questions and answer them. Right. So for the parents, the first is, what is the spell bee for, and how do we approach it? How do we, what is the utility? How can we use it? So see, the spell bee originated in the US, where they found that children were getting weaker in spellings, especially with electronic media, short forms coming in, SMS language, computer language, LOL and stuff like that. So that helps students become better at the language. And there are a lot of benefits with learning to write and read. There are direct correlations to cognitive ability, which means the intelligence with writing. So the more the children write, the better the brain develops. So that is clear with a lot of experiments done. So children who write will always end up learning more than children who just read. So with this in mind, the spell bee started many years ago. It's a very successful concept in the US, and it has been gaining grounds in India. Now, there's one challenge here for Indians, which is in addition to the challenges faced by children in the US, is that English is not a native language for us. We don't speak English at home, and therefore there is a lack of exposure when you compare, Indian children to the children of the US or the UK. So there the children speak English right from birth. They are exposed to a lot more English, a lot more language, words, pronunciation, which our children lack here. Now the spell bee is especially more beneficial to Indians because of that reason. So when the children lack the exposure, we can get it with this way. But what are the challenges? See, we don't hear English correct. So there are a lot of issues with pronunciation. So common words like tuition, which is wrong. The correct pronunciation is tuition, not tuition. So you rarely hear that in India. People just say tuition. In Gujarat, I've heard people say two son. So I tell them, okay, two sons hai, toh two daughters ki dare. It's so bad. It morphed the word into two son. So that plus a common word like query is wrong. It's actually query, not query. So a lot of these words which are mispronounced, base, it's base, not base. B-A-S-E, Indians usually pronounce as base, but it's not a Z sound, it's a S sound. You say base, right? So a lot of these issues with pronunciation, and that is where we need a lot of input. The child needs to hear correct English. So we need to pick up sources of correct English. So there are two approaches here. There's a short-term approach for this particular test, and there's a long-term approach looking at not only future spell bees, but also basic fluency of the language, gaining more words of the vocab, expanding the lexicon, understanding the language. So we'll first look at the long-term approach, because the long-term approach is then compressed. We sort of change that a little bit to suit our short-term need. So what is a long-term concept? Now, words, vocabulary is essentially memory. There is no way out of that. If I say I want a vocab of 10,000 words, I need to remember those 10,000 words, their spelling, their pronunciation, their meanings, how to use them in a sentence. I frequently see people at the IELTS and other level, they want to make the language impressive. So they use a lot of words, but they don't make sense because that's not how the words are used, especially, when a native language speaker writes that way, right? So there's a lot of issues with that. And that is bound to happen with any country where the native language is not English. The native language will have its influence. So we will think in Hindi or Marathi or Gujarati or Tamil or Telugu, and then translate at some level into English. And that is what causes some of the grammatical problems and pronunciation problems. So vocab is a long-term approach. And it depends, because it depends on memory, we need to understand how we remember. This is the right age, fourth, fifth standard, if the child starts memorizing words, reading, then you will see a massive improvement by the time the child is in the 10th. And the competitive tests then become very, very easy. One simple thing I would like, ask you all to just think in your mind is, compare the level of a state board student to that of a CBSE or that of an ICSE level student. You will see a marked difference in the language abilities. Most of you are from, I think, small background like I am. We are from small towns, vernacular mediums. So we understand that because we ourselves have faced the problems with language, right? So when we see someone who's from an English medium ICSE school and we see the difference, that difference is there because ICSE students are exposed to more English. They have access to better teachers, better resources, and that is what makes a difference in the formative ages. And that is where the school plays a major part. If it's a good school, you'll see children in CII are more articulate. They're able to better express themselves. They may be wrong grammatically, but they're able to express the thought. That is more important initially, more than grammar, that they are able to express. They are more incisive. They are able to go deeper into the conversation, analyze things. And that comes from the environment the child has. So that in the background plays, the background, you've got already a good school there. So that is going to help you. But how do you accelerate that? So we learn, we have to understand how we learn and we remember. So scientists doing research on memory found that if you read something once, you will forget up to 90% of that in 24 hours. Right? That happens to you. There's too much information, especially in this age. There's so much information bombarding our brain. It's like, coming in from all directions. The brain kitna yaad rakhega? Right? So the brain filters out things. So brain thinks this is not important. Let it go. I'm not going to store it in my permanent memory. So RAM mein rehta hai. RAM se reboot kiya. Raat ko so gaye. RAM flush ho gaya. Chala gaya. Memory goes. So that happened. Now how to get it from the RAM to the ROM? Andar ki memory kise dalenge? So the same experiment found that if a person reads something once every day for 10 days, then you remember up to 90%. Average 70% you remember. So 70, 80, depending on the person's brains, you remember up to 90% of that. So if I say, remember average 70, 80, younger children have it more, they remember more than older people would do. So if I were to sit and learn that way, I'd remember maybe 70%. Children would remember 80%. So then how do you approach that in the long run? So here's what you do. You make lists of words. Depending on the child's capacity to process, you can have anything from 50 to 100 words in the list. Now read this list for 10 days, right? It doesn't take more than 15, 20 minutes. And this is something even adults can do if they want to improve their vocab. This is the same method for everyone. So you take this list of 50 to 100 words, read it once every day for 10 days. Repeat this cycle for 6 times. So you process 6 different lists. Right, so that's 60 days. And you've got about anywhere from 300 to 600 words done, depending on your capacity. the next 10-day cycle, you revise all these words. So on the first day of the cycle, you read all the words and you tick the ones you remember. So you'll remember what at least 50, 60, 70% of them. So whatever 20, 30% you've forgotten, you read again for the other 9 days of this cycle. So by the end of 70 days, 60 plus 170, you will have covered anywhere from 300 to 600 words, of which conservatively counting that you've forgotten 20, even after that, you still got about 250 to 500 words, 480 words that you remember. So let's take it on the lower side. It's 225 or whatever, right? Now, if you repeat this 70-day cycle for 5 days, which means that you spare 10, 15 minutes every day for vocab, come what may. And for children, this cycle can last as much as 3 or 4 years. Then I'll explain the benefits to you a little later. So how many words do you process? So if in 70 days, you process anywhere from, say, 250 to 500 words, say average 300 pakadte, bacha kam pakdo. So in 350 days, which is 5 times the cycle, you will do 5 times this, which is 1500 words. Now, if a child continues this for 3 to 4 or maybe even 5 years, imagine 5 into 1500 is 7500 words that the word child adds to the vocab. Now, there are simple techniques that you can use to multiply whatever words you learn, whether it's 1500 or 3000, whatever word you learn. So this, let me tell you, parents, is a huge number. This is a huge jump in the language ability. And with that, logical ability, expression, understanding, comprehension, you know, all that will also get a big boost. Now, how do you multiply this? The second step after memory is understanding the patterns. You have prefixes and you have suffixes. So I frequently teach with this because this is a very common word and we know all the forms of the word, is the word ject. Object means push. Yes, bacha.
Sir, I was saying that can you, I have not written that you have written before.
What, bacha?
Sir, I was saying that that you have written before. I don't have written before one.
And that's okay. That's not important. You have to understand the process. So what you need to do is just get down and make a list of words and read the same list for 10 days. And then you make another list and read it for 10 days. That's what you need to do, bacha, right? Okay, let's look at this word ject. Now, ject means push. Now, I can add different prefixes to change the meaning. So I have inject, I have eject, I have reject, I have deject, I have subject, I have project, I have interject, trajectory. Children, please mute yourselves. Then with each word, I can have different suffixes like inject. Now, inject is a word which is a verb. With that, with two other forms of the verb, you have injecting and injected, which can be used as nouns and adjectives. Then you have injection. Injector is the person who injects something or the thing that injects it. They have injectable, something that can be injected into a thing. Then you have injected as the person. So if I get an injection from a doctor, I've got a vaccine. As I say, I've been vaccinated. I have been injected, right? So injected, the substance can also be called the injected substance. The person is injected. So inject, injection, injected, injectable, injector, right? Eject, ejection, ejectable, ejected, reject, rejection, rejected, rejector. So with each word, you'll have a lot of combinations. So once I understand this concept of root words, right? So that would help me with that. So what is a root word? A root word is usually a Latin or a Greek word, which is now part of English. So ject is one of those. So with a root word, you can have a prefix and a suffix. And with the suffix, you change the form. It becomes a noun or a verb or an adjective or an adverb, depending on that. For example, ly is a common word ending to make an adverb, right? Common, commonly, uncommon, uncommonly, regular, regularly, sweet, sweetly, nice, nicely, rough, roughly. So you know that adding an ly makes it an adverb. So you learn the suffixes, and with the prefixes, you can add more meanings, right? For example, you have, say, went. In went. It means to bring in, so make something new. Or if you say vert, vert means to turn. So divert, revert, convert, right? So revert, what does revert means? To turn back. So revert means, this is again a very, very commonly misused word in India. Revert does not mean reply. Please revert back. Revert means you go back to an earlier state. So if I find a magic medicine that makes me 20 years old again, then I have reverted to my late, you know, early youth. That is revert. Purane state mein chala jana. So if I'm married and by suddenly by magic, I can make the marriage dissolve and make it a fact that I was never married, not divorced or not separated, make it a fact that I was never married, then I've reverted to my unmarried state. So revert means that. Revert does not mean reply, but we find that very often used, you know, as please revert. So how can I revert? Please reply. Actually, that's a word. So again, coming back to that word. Word means turn. So vert, divert, revert, convert. Then V-E-R-G-E is also based on that word. So diverge, converge, right? Then vert, say vertical. So vertical means in a straight line, standing line. Vertical, vertically, right? So a lot of these words based on the word vert. So I have prefixes, I have suffixes, I have different forms of the word. So teaching children root words is another great way to pick up vocabulary. So if you pick up 100 root words, say each word gives you anywhere from 5 to 20, 30 new words. So teaching the child 100 root words gives the child another 1,000 words. Plus, more important, the root word. Children, please keep yourself muted. We have very little time. I'll give you time to answer your questions. Please write down any questions that you have. Yeah. So with root words, you have the ability to understand a new word you've never seen before. Suppose I come across a word I've never seen before. So with the analysis of the root word, what the prefix is, what the suffix is, and what the root word is, if I understand the root word, then I can make a very good guess to the actual meaning of the word. So that's very helpful when you're appearing for competitive tests like a CAT or a GRE and you've not seen the word before. But if you know the root word, you can make an educated guess, you know, even with the words around it, they help you to understand what the word means. So with root words, that's another ability that children get. So that's another very important way to pick up vocabulary, is to look at root words and understand how they work with prefixes and suffixes, right? Then a third and the most important source, which you cannot avoid, is reading. Ultimately, any language is input. Listen, read. Input is equal to output. If I fill in 5 liters of petrol in my car, I cannot expect to drive to Bombay. So if I want my child to excel at language, aur main sochta hu mera bachcha dur tak jana chahiye, to dur tak jane ke liye petrol bhi utna dur tak dalna padega, tank puri banni padegi, khali ho gayi to dusri bar banni padegi, khali ho gayi to teesri bar banni padegi. So input, very important. Input karte jao, process karte jao, keep on adding, keep on processing. So reading, very, very important. And why more so? Because there's a lot of knowledge, lot of words that are contextual. Now what do I mean by contextual? They are dependent on a story. They are from a story or some incident or some person or some historical fact, which people living in those countries would know, but we wouldn't, right? So how many parents here would know what I mean if I say, main 11 number ki bus se aaya school? Anyone here who knows the meaning of that? 11 number ki. Children, don't answer, please. You all know that.
By walking.
Yes. Why is that 11 number bus? So, do pair hai na, to 11 number. So that is contextual. People who've been to Bombay would know 11 number bus kya hai. Someone strange in Bombay, suppose you just have to go 500 meters and you ask someone bus stop pe, bhai yahan jana hai, kaun si bus milegi? Bolega 11 number ki bus. And that fellow will poor guy, look, 11 number bus kidhar hai, bus stop pe to number nahi hai. So then you ask someone, 11 number bus kidhar aayega? So then a proper Bombayite, you know, would guide you. But otherwise, someone would tease you and say, koi bhi bus stop pe jao, sab jagah bus stop pe nahi hoge, to bhi mil jayega bus aap. Because it's not a bus, right? It's walking. So that is contextual knowledge. Right? Another example is like Harish Chandra. If I tell you, main Harish Chandra nahi hu, what do you understand of that?
Jo acha sach bolta
hai. If I tell you, ye iski biwi to Savitri jaisi hai, what do you understand from that? Right? Koi khayega ta bologe, Kumbhakarna ki tarah kyun khata hai? No, but someone who's from England or someone who doesn't. How will he know who's Kumbhakarna and what he has to do with eating and sleeping? Right. So that's contextual knowledge. You get it from your culture, your language, your the literature and the sahitya jo bolte hindi mein usse aata hai. So English also has a lot of this, you know, which affects the language. And unfortunately, we don't know because we don't read those books. Right? How many of us have read the classics like Huckleberry Finn, Tom Sawyer, right? Treasure Island, and you've got Jane Eyre, The House with Seven Gables, Westward Ho, Call of the Wild, right? How many books? There's more than 1,200 books that a child is supposed to have read at least 200 or 300 in the US. And if not all of them, the child would have at least read shortened versions in comic form or abridged version, or at least had an extract from that in school and read that. We don't have that. And sometimes we need to connect to the culture and the language. So a lot of these words, children, please keep yourself muted. There's a lot of disturbance here. Yeah, thank you. So there's a lot of words and concepts that come that way, which we don't understand the context. For example, in India, this term Achilles heel is quite well known. Somehow, you know, that has caught people's attention and that is taught in every vocab list. But where does it come from? What does it mean? A-C-H-I-L-L-E-S, Achilles heel. It's from the Greek mythology. It's one of the characters from the Iliad or the, you know, the Troy, the Trojan War, as we call it. So what is his story? There was a god who came to earth and married a human being, and she gave birth to a son. Now the god was very happy when he got a son. So he told his wife that you can ask for a boon for your son, our son. So the wife said, make my son immortal. So the god replied that immortality was for gods, not for humans. So humans could not be granted that. So he said, ask for something else. So then the woman said, okay, make it so that no weapon can kill my son. So the god says, okay. Now in their mythology, when people die, their souls go on a boat on the river Styx, S-T-Y-X. And then they go to Hades, where their heart is weighed on a terrazu, and there's a feather on the other side. So if the person has committed any sin, then the heart is heavy and it goes down. So the person is sent to Hades, which is their version of hell. And if the heart is pure, then it is lighter than a feather. It goes up and the person is sent to heaven. So this river Hades is only for the dead people. So the god went there and he caught his son with the left ankle and dipped him in the water. Now, wherever the water touched the body, it became like a kavach. Think of the kavach in Indian context. Who had the kavach in the Mahabharata? Context. There are a lot of similarities in the story.
Karna.
Yes, Karna had the kavach that no weapon would hurt him. Think of a lot of similarities that way. So he was invulnerable. So in the Trojan War, when one queen fell in love with another king and ran away with that king to his country, which was an island. Now think Ramayana. And slight difference is Ravan took away Sita. Here Sita, the wife, went willingly. There's a difference there. And then the king, the husband, takes his friends and his armies and attacks the island like in Ramayana. And then there's a very long war in which a lot of people die. Now, one of the characters in the war is this Achilles. Now, he was a very brave warrior. And because no weapon could kill him, he was very, fatal for the enemies. They tried to kill him, but they couldn't. He kept killing a lot of the people from Troy. So, hamare Narad Muni jaise, jo mischief karte, waise Greek god hai Mercury. Woh ek baar Troy gaya aur bole, isko maro na, marte kyun nahi aap, itne log ko marta hai. So, they said, he can't be killed. So then he doesn't tell them the history. He tells, find out, how did he become like that? So then the people of Troy researched that and they found out that he was invulnerable because he was dipped in the river Styx. And wherever the water touched him, no weapon could hurt him. So that's when they realized that the ankle where the god had caught him was not touched by the water. So that was a weak point. That is where the weapon could hurt him. So next day, all the warriors were instructed, hit his ankle, aim for his left ankle. So Mara, samne ek arrow lag gaya, penetrated his skin and he bled to death. So that is what is the story of Achilles' heel. That was the only point of his body where he could be hurt. Now, what does that mean in modern vocab? It means that the weak point of any person. So if I'm an executive in a multinational company and I'm not able to relate to, say, you know, some people, I find it difficult to get along with people. So because it's a large organization and I need that ability, then that becomes my Achilles heel, that I'm not able to relate to a lot of people. I can only relate to some, not everybody. So I need to develop my personality where I can get along with more people.
Sir, which is the word for that? Can you
Sorry?
Which is the word? Can you please repeat?
Achilles heel. I'll write it down.
Brad Pitt movie.
Achilles heel. The apostrophe is after this, huh? Because his name is with an S. Achilles is his name. A-C-H.
There is a movie also, Troy.
Yes, yes. There'll be lots of movies. Troy hai, the Iliad hai. Then you have based on that, no, not just Achilles, but based on that, you've got Jason and the Argonauts. Kafi sari Greek mythology pe hai. Then you have the Seven Tasks of Hercules. Bahut sare. In fact, the word not comes from the Greek word not, which means sea. So sea pe jane wale sailors are called nauts. So agro ship pe jane wale are called agronauts. Taking the same concept, people who go into space in America are called, what are they called? Children?
Astronauts.
Why? Because in America, they call space astro. In Russia, it is called cosmos. So they are called cosmonaut. So they take the same Greek root not, but in Russia, they are called cosmonauts because cosmos is the Greek word, the word Russians use for space. And Americans call them astronauts. Right. So nautical, nautica. Right. Same root, sea. Right. So not means sea. So people who fly in space are cosmonauts or astronauts. Right. So not again is a Greek root. A lot of words, nautical. What's the difference between a nautical mile and a regular mile? Find out, children. Land pe mile ka distance kya, sea mein land ka distance kya, mile ka distance. Right? There's a difference in the distance when you measure it. A nautical mile is different from a land mile. You need to find out. Anyway, let's come back to our main thing. So understanding these stories by reading them is a great, very great way of picking up this contextual knowledge. Children, have you all read Mickey and Donald comics? No? Okay. Do you know who Donald Duck's uncle is?
Yes, sir.
Who is he?
Uncle Scrooge.
Scrooge. Very nice name. You know where Scrooge comes from?
No, sir.
No. It's a very famous story and it's a must read. Every child in America has to read this story at least once in the school life. It's called Christmas Carol. There's one man who's very rich, very stingy, khanju se, paisa apne aap pe nahi kharcha karta. Winter mein he burns one piece of coal. Ek koila jalata hai. And you know what he tells people? Log bolte, garmi kaise hogi room mein? How will you feel warm? He says, coal costs money. And when I see money burning in my fireplace, main andar se itna jal jata hu ki garam ho jata hu. That's how khanju sees. He doesn't even burn coal for himself. So he of course doesn't give money to people. He's got only one living relative, a nephew. And the nephew is cut off. The nephew doesn't get any money at all. This fellow saves. So one day he gets visited by ghosts, a single ghost. And on the Christmas Eve, there's a ghost from the Christmas past, ghost of the present Christmas, and ghost of the future Christmas. So parents, if you've seen the movie, Ghost of Girlfriend Past, same reference, Christmas Carol ka. Ghost of Christmas Past, say Ghost of Girlfriend Past. That's a movie. So a lot of these references which he failed to understand, right? So this fellow then changes and he becomes generous. So now the old character kaisa tha? Stingy, very rich, not married, doesn't share money with his nephew. Think of Donald Duck, Uncle Scrooge, very rich, stingy, not married, doesn't share money with his nephew. So a child in America reading will immediately make the connection between Uncle Scrooge and Scrooge. That the person name in the story is Ebenezer Scrooge. So even the name is the same. So Ebenezer Scrooge becomes Scrooge McDuck. So a lot of this contextual knowledge in English. So that will only come from reading. The more you read, the more you gain that knowledge. So a lot of stuff to read, lots of stuff. You'll go crazy reading. I've lost track of the books I've read. I had a peak reading when I was in the 6th, 7th standard. My family relocated from Mumbai to Gujarat. And I went from an ICSE school to a state board school. The level was pathetic. There was no one to speak English to in Gujarat. I was a 6th standard student and my English was better than my B.A. teachers. So again, not to blame them because they were a product of the system. So in Gujarat, the language was that poor. Nobody spoke English. So I don't really blame the teachers. So I had a lack of practice. So then I found this wonderful library. I would cycle 5 or 6 kilometers from my home, borrow 4 books at a time because that's the maximum they gave. come back home, read them, go exchange. So I would read one novel anywhere from 150 to 300 pages in one day and exchange the books twice a week, you know, three times in 2 weeks. So I was averaging about 5, 6, 7 books a week. So after 2 weeks, the librarian asked me, beta, tu book padhta hai ki aise hi le aata hai? Bola, kyun? She said, aap itni book le jaate ho, yahan book, ek book le jaate hai, hume postcard likhna padhta hai, 6 mahine tak dete nahi log wapas. So no, I read it. So anyway, the point was I read a lot. I had a lot of free time because school was very easy for me. The language, the standard, I mean, it was all what I'd covered in the 5th and 6th standard, you know, coming to me in the 7th and 8th standard. So I was very lucky to get that break and I read a lot of books and that is what made my language very strong. So it's only that exposure. You need to read, listen. Now, children, for you today in this world, how do you get that exposure? So you're very, very lucky because, you know, we didn't have so many resources. We had hardly any resources. If I found a difficult word and we only had those pocket dictionaries, Oxford key. If you wanted to look up a word that was not in that dictionary, we'd go first to our school library that had about 8 or 10 dictionaries. If you didn't find the word there, then there were 3 libraries in the city, all far apart. So you'd go to the closest one, which was 5 kilometers away from my home. I would cycle there, look up those 5 or 6 dictionaries they had. And if I didn't find it there, then I had to go to the other libraries, which are further away. So I would end up cycling 7, 8 kilometers just to find out the meaning. Now, what do children do? Jugal bhai jindabad, Google mein puch lo. 2 minutes, you got the word, right? So that way, you're very lucky to have so many resources. So there's audiobooks. If you cannot buy books, you got ebooks. Ebooks are a great way. I ran out of space for books at home. My mother and my wife told me, abhi book aayegi, to aapke cupboard mein rakho, aapke kapde nikal do. Ghar mein jagah nahi hai books rakhne ki. I had more than 2,000 books at home. Right, so out of space, what to do? Ghar to bada nahi le sakte. So then I made the book small. Now I've got ebooks. I don't buy books. I only download ebooks. Sometimes I buy them, but mostly I download them. And I've got more than 8,000 or 10,000 books on my computer. So it's only ebooks for me now. So you've got ebooks, you've got audiobooks, which is a very great way for children to listen. Why? Because it's the language spoken by native English speakers. So you understand how the language is spoken by people who speak it from birth. The pronunciation, the diction, the way you speak. Indians have this sing-song pattern, you know? Na 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 na. That's how, you know, Indians end up speaking. Ma'am, I told you, no? See, that's the Indian way of speaking. And especially how when children say good morning to me, I find it very irritating. I get angry sometimes. Huh? Good morning, teacher. Are you putting me to sleep? Are you singing a lullaby to me? Na 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 na. So that language, you know, the rhythm of the language, the music of language is all mixed up. So how do you speak English? If you listen to me now, I'm not saying that I'm like a native speaker, but I'm pretty close to it because of the long experience I've had. So if you want to do that, you need a lot of exposure to English that is spoken by them. So if you listen to correct English, if you read correct English, that's what your output will be, right? Wrong input, wrong output. Right input, right in output. That's how it is. So if you listen to English that way, you pick up the diction, you'll pick up the pronunciation, you'll pick up the music, the rhythm of the language. So there's a lot of audiobooks. Parents, you can download them. You've got a lot of torrents. I've been downloading books for the last decade now. So I've got, I think about, unfortunately, I lost a lot of my audiobooks when my drive went off. I lost about 500 or 600 audiobooks. So then I started downloading them, but I have about, I think, 100, 150 now. I don't get much time to download them now. But there's quite a lot of books that I have. And they're very good. There are a lot of children's books. There are a lot of books for adults. So like you've got books on self-help. You've got books on how to repair your relations, books on how to change yourself, how to accept change. Almost any book that is written can be converted to the audio form. If you don't mind paying a little, there's a platform called Audible, which has, I don't know how many lakhs of books in the audio format, right? So you can probably download a few from there if you want, or you can just browse the net and you'll get a lot of audiobooks. For children, you can read the series, say, for example, how many of you read Enid Blyton? Have you read Enid Blyton? Famous Five, Five Find Outers, Secret
Sir,
Seven.
I've read some of them.
Adventure series.
I have not read the Famous Five. I want to read the Famous Five and Secret Seven.
Correct. So Secret Seven, Bacha, you outgrown. Secret Seven is for third and fourth graders. Graders maybe. Y'all should be reading the Famous Five also. You should be outgrowing now. Right? But you can start reading them. Why am I saying what that is? there's a very nice audiobook version of the whole series of 24 books. And that is exact word to word. Now, a lot of times what happens is that when they read the audiobook, there are slight differences because there are different publications which have different words. So you don't have the same text and the same audio. So the audio will be different from the text. With Annette Blyton series, what happens is that the word is modern. The copyright still exists. So the audiobook matches the written book exactly. So the child can read and listen at the same time. Now, that is a very great way of picking up the language because you're reading, you see the word and you're listening to it. So you know how it's pronounced. You see the whole sentence and you see how it's spoken. Where is the stress? How you stress it? So it's more beneficial to do both at the same time. So that is very helpful. So you can do that. You can download the audiobooks for the Famous Five series and listen to the book and read it at the same time. So that's one way, audiobooks, reading, listening. That's the only way to go forward, children. The more books you read, the better it is, right? So you should have a target. By the time I turn 20, I should have read 5,000 books. Yes, children, 5,000 books. How will you read that? How will you read 5,000 books?
Oh my goodness, sir. I want to say something.
Yes, Tamanna, speak.
Actually, sir, when I was at my home, so, sir, I had... I was reading about treasure only because when I read treasure books and it is very adventurous, so I always read the treasure books. Mm-hmm. So some years back, I read the treasure in the beach. So it was very adventure.
Correct. So adventurous. Yes. It was very adventurous. Right. So you'll find more, Bacha. There's so many more books you can read. Like children, you got the Percy Jackson. You got...
Sir, I am reading that now.
Yeah. Then you got the Harry Potter series. Percy Jackson, there's 5 or 6 series now. Then you got the authors like Roald Dahl.
One more continued series of the
same. I have read Harry Potter.
Sir, yes. I have written Harry Potter.
Read, Bacha. Yeah. The correct word is read.
I have also read Harry Potter.
Correct. Children. So you'll have read a lot of books. There are a lot of books there. Roald Dahl, Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, Charlie and the Glass Elevator, S.O. Trot, The Witches, The BFG. So many books by him. They're all very nice, right?
Sir,
so,
one day there was a movie session and we see the Charlie and the Chocolate Factory.
We saw Charlie and the Chocolate Factory. Yeah, so I don't see that movie very often because every time I see it, I want to eat chocolate. So I sit with 2 bars next to me. So by the time the movie finishes, I've eaten 2 bars of chocolate. Right now, I can't afford to eat that much sugar, so I don't watch the movie.
Sir, I have read the Chocolate Factory movie.
I have read. I wish they could sell the book, you know, printed on chocolates. After you read it, you can eat it. How would that be?
Wow.
Yeah, imagine you read one page.
Then every child will read that book.
True. Everyone would want to read the book, right? Okay, fine. So let's get back to the topic. So that's the long-term approach, parents. You have a list generated and you keep having the child read the list over a span of time, 10 days for each list. And then maybe once in every 6 months, you revise, you know, spend 3 or 4 days revising all the words you've done. Reading, very important. Listening, very important. So these are for the long-term. You're ensuring that your child is ready for the competitive test, for reality. No, and the child has that linguistic ability that you want, has so many words the child knows and knows how to use them. You then look at the root words also. So you look at words from different sources. If you want to find out more about how these words are, they're actually called allusions. Allude, which means indirect reference to. Allusions, right? A-L-L-U-D-E, allude. Allude means refer to something indirect. Like, so for example, if I say that he is a Babbitt, what does that mean? Now, Babbitt is the name of a book in which the main character is a middle-class man who works hard, earns money, you know, tries to fit into society. And generally, you know, the problems that we as, you know, the middle-class people face. So because of his life and his, you know, problems and all, he then sort of becomes very narrow-minded. You know, yes, I can make a, you know, how that typical Indian middle class people are projected in movies. समाज का डर रहता है, ये मत करो वो मत करो. सो अ बैबिट इज एग्जैक्टली अ पर्सन लाइक दैट, राइट? देन यू मस्ट हैव सीन दैट सीरीज, एटलीस्ट हर्ड ऑफ इट, मुंगेरी लाल के हसीन सपने, राइट? बेस्ड ऑन द बुक, जैसे आई फॉरगॉट द नेम ऑफ द बुक, वॉल्टर मिट्टी करके एक बुक था, the dreams of something of Walter Mitty. So there's this man who's got a very unpleasant life, so he keeps taking, you know, getting lost in daydreams, and he daydreams about everything. So that's how they get the story. So even today, about I guess 30-40% of Hindi movies are based on English novels. You don't realize that, right? But they are, and these things get carried on. So it's not only English, it's from other cultures also they pick up stuff. So there's this movie called Seven Samurai which was remade in English by the name of The Magnificent Seven. Now that was again remade a few years ago. They've got a modern version of that. That was made into Hindi with the movie name Saat Uchakke. Right. So a lot of stuff like that. So there's a lot of movies that get copied, a lot of stories, a lot of movies based on stories there. So that helps you, you know, understand the language, understand the source. It makes you a better person. Your cognitive ability, your logical ability also increases with language, right? And that's found, that scientists have found, researchers have found that children who write, people who write, are better to remember and able to process information better than children who just read. So children, please remember, that's very important for you all to write, because when you coordinate, your brain has to think at a faster rate, slow it down to tell your hand to write it, and you form the letters. That process, you know, makes your brain stronger. So writing is very, very important. Please don't ignore writing. So that's for the long term. Coming back to the short term, you just have a very short time. Now, what do? You have maybe a month or so. So we pick on the same concept of reading something for 10 days. The only difference being, because we just have a month and we can only do 3 cycles, I will have to break up my words. So you got a list of words that will be asked in the spell bee. So you have sit with your child and find out the words the child knows. You tick them off. You just revise them once or twice in that 1 month. The ones that the child does not know, you will form into lists. Try and organize it in a way based on some topics. So some adjectives together, some words, you know, to do with emotions maybe, or some words to do with professions, maybe separate them. Try and separate them into different lists and make lists about 50 to 100 words depending on your child's capacity. So you'll have about 4 or 5 lists the child has to do in a day, in a 10-day cycle. Spread it out during the day. So one list in the morning, one maybe 2 hours later. Keep a gap of 2 hours in between. Your children are awake for about 10, 12 hours a day. So they can cover 5 hours, 5 lists, 6 lists in a day. So every 2 hours, they read one list. So you have to grade them. So 10 o'clock, 12 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 4 o'clock, 6 o'clock, 8 o'clock list. So that way the child will pick up the list at that time, spend 10, 15 minutes reading that. So if the child reads all the words ultimately 10 times, the child should remember 70-80% of them, which is a pretty good target. I would not put children into too much pressure. See, as a person, even I don't like too much pressure. I don't function when there's a lot of pressure. Not a lot of people like that. You know, your working gets affected when there's a lot of pressure, especially to do something that you don't like. So if you make learning unpleasant for children, they will not like it and their efficiency will go down. So make it enjoyable. Give them lists that they can process, they can understand. And you will see that they will start picking up words. So in the short term, that is what you do. And children, when you're reading the list, make sure that you write the words at least twice, once or twice. So that helps you remember the spellings also, right? So that is a basic outline. Any questions about this, people, parents, children, or the approach to remembering?
When you talk about the making the list, and when the child reads the word, so in the what they actually test, whether they test the total spellings or the...
Yes. So the child has to read the word, read the meaning and recite the spelling. All three.
Okay. So they also need to know the meaning of those words.
Right? Absolutely. See, otherwise, what's the point? If I give you 20 weapons, but I don't show you how to hold them or fight with them, then what's the point of giving you the weapons? Shabd hathiyar hai. Aapko upyog karna aana chahiye.
Okay.
कौन से मौके पे कौन सा यूज करना है. गले में हार पहना नहीं किया. जब चाकू लगा दोगे किसी को तो क्या होगा. इफ यू इंस्टेड ऑफ प्रेजिंग समवन यूज अ वर्ड दैट डेप्रिशिएट्स द पर्सन व्हाट विल हैपन. यू नीड टू नो द मीनिंग ऑफ द वर्ड. नो दैट इज एब्सोल्युटली नेसेसरी. हत्यारे कैसे बताना उपयोग करना आना चाहिए. सो इफ यू हैव टू शो योर चाइल्ड हाउ टू यूज एन एग्जैक्ट वर्ड राइट So a lot of times we use, so for example, I said revert, right? We use revert so many times, but it's absolutely incorrect. Revert means purane state mein chale jana. Abhi wo banda kaise revert karega?
Right.
Mail mein kitni baar likhte, please revert.
Makes sense. Thank you. Yeah.
So important, very important for the meaning. And that's what I said, you know, IELTS mein or, you know, in all these exams I see Indian adults writing nonsense at times. Purane, you know, they want to show off that they know words. Or itna sara bhel kichda bana dete, you know, usal bana dete, words dal dal ke. It doesn't make sense. It's not natural. An English person, English speaking person wouldn't use words like that. So they also need to know how to use the words. Meaning to ek baat hai. But meaning janne ke baad, how to use that in a sentence is also important. Right now for the spell bee, that doesn't matter. Spell bee only looks at what? You know the meaning, you know the spelling, and you know the pronunciation. Ye teen cheez dekhti hai spell bee. In the longer term, when you want to benefit from that effort put into the spell bee, you need to know the meaning of the word and with the context, how to use it. That is very important, right? Any other questions? Children, parents? No? Okay. So then I'll move to a few spelling tips, right? There where there's a big challenge with English spelling because English is not a phonetic language. Phonetic means that what you speak is what you write. Now, why does English have this challenge? Because English is very greedy. English is very open-minded. England ruled over half the world. There was a saying, the sun never sets on the British Empire. क्योंकि ऑस्ट्रेलिया से लेके अमेरिका तक पूरा उनका राज्य था. Look at it, ऑस्ट्रेलिया, parts of Asia, Singapore, Thailand का पार्ट, इंडिया, पाकिस्तान, बांग्लादेश, अरेबिया का हिस्सा, साउथ अफ्रीका, right? Then they had England and of course America. So which geography is left out, right? So they span the globe. So at any point of the day, you know, at any point of the 24-hour day, there would be day in one part of the empire and they would be functioning. So that's why they said, you know, the sun never sets. Itna bada world empire hai ki pure empire pe suraj dubi nahi sakta. Now, what happened because of that is that when they started ruling over all these countries, they had to interact with a lot of local people of different cultures, different languages, different customs. Everywhere they encountered a lot of new ideas, concepts, words, which they did not have in English. And anyway, the old English was a amalgamation of three different languages. Gaelic was the original language they had in England. And when the Roman Empire invaded them, they got Latin and Greek. So the old English was anywhere a combination of three languages. And then you get all these. I have a dictionary about 600 or 700 pages, which has only words of Asian origin. Only Asian origin ke word. 600 page ki dictionary. Right? Imagine, bache log, imagine 600 pages worth of words only from India and Japan and China and Asia. Mainly 70-80% India, Arabic or Urdu language, ke, Indian languages. Ke, itne sare words. So what happened was English absorbed all these words. I mean, of course, if the language was, original language is German or French.
So they learn words, but they don't give it back.
That is for us to take, no? Humne liya na, Hindi mein kitne English word hai abhi? Mujhe train ka English word, Hindi word batao. रेल गाड़ी नहीं होता रेल भी इंग्लिश है लौपद गामी नहीं बोलते प्योर हिंदी में हाउ मेनी पीपल से लौपद गामी नहीं टेल मी व्हाट इज इजी ट्रेन और लौपद गामी नहीं और स्टीम इंजन का तो उससे भी ज्यादा बड़ा है कुछ भाप का दबान से चलने वाला इंजन वाला लौपद गामी नहीं विल से दैट No one will say that. So we've taken a lot of English words. We are taking it back. But hum itne greedy nahi hai. Humne itne English word nahi liye jitne English ne dusre language se liye. Right? So anyway, what happens is that these words then follow the rules of their language. Pronunciation, spelling. Isliye English mein khichdi ho gaya. English bhi hai, French bhi hai, German bhi hai, Spanish bhi hai, Hindi bhi hai, Urdu bhi hai, Bengali hai, Gujarati hai, Marathi hai, Tamil hai, Telugu hai, sab kuch hai English mein. तो क्या होगा कंफ्यूजन सो लॉट ऑफ स्पेलिंग्स डोंट फॉलो द इंग्लिश रूल्स दे फॉलो द रूल्स ऑफ द ओरिजिनल लैंग्वेज एंड देयरफॉर वी हैव डिफरेंट साउंड्स दैट इज अ मेन चैलेंज सो बिकॉज इट्स नॉट फोनेटिक देन इट बिकम्स कंफ्यूजिंग फॉर चिल्ड्रन टू अंडरस्टैंड नॉट ओनली चिल्ड्रन इवन यू गेट कंफ्यूज आई सी अ वर्ड फॉर अ फर्स्ट टाइम I don't know how to pronounce it. I may make an educated guess, but I may not be 100% correct.
Excuse
right?
me, sir.
Yes, bacha.
Speak. Sir, what do you say? What do you say?
Train, bacha. We call a train a laupath gamini. Laupath means lokhand. Lau means iron. Path means path. So something, gamini means moving. So something that moves on iron path. Laupath gamini.
Sir, if English is not a phonetic language, in lot of schools, the English is taught with respect
correct, correct.
To phonics.
I'll come to that. I'll come to yeah. that. So see, phonetics is the study of sound. So English में जो बोलते वो लिखते नहीं बन sound तो है ना उसका study तो कर ही सकते ना you understand mm-hmm. so phonetics is the study of the sounds of a language so English has sounds there are patterns but for a person who is a non-native speaker these patterns are not known since childhood so that creates a little confusion plus there's the added fact that local language can influence both होता है today I can make out about 50-60% of the time I only speak English and the person I speak to would only speak English. But I can make out whether the person is a Gujarati or a Marathi or a Tamil or a Bengali or an Odia or someone from Bihar. With the way they speak English, huh? They don't speak their local language. From the way they speak English, I can make out what part of India they are from. Because I am a Gujarati, I recognize Gujarati is better. So if the person speaks to me, I can make out whether he's from Surat, whether he's from Ahmedabad, whether he's from Baroda, whether he's from Rajkot. 50% of the time I can make out. Why? Because a local language is different and when you recognize that, you recognize the influence on English and then you realize where he's from or she's from. So local language plays a big influence on the language, right? The way they say Gujarati is chij instead of cheese. Yeah, give me one chij sandwich. Yeah, Marathi, they have their own problems, right? Because the English sounds are not the English sounds, the Marathi sounds, right? Pleasure, it's a great pleasure to meet you. That's Marathi. They can't say the word sh, pleasure nahi bol sakte. Gujarati mein sir, sh swap hota hai. This is good, ki jaga this is good. She told me, instead of she told me. Of native language influence. Again, it's, I'm not talking about good or bad. It's the way people speak. So it is. There's nothing good or bad about it. But when you go to a larger platform, you're meeting people from a larger area, from countries, different countries. Then you have to make your English as clear as possible. Take away regional influence so that more people can understand. And that is where the effort has to be. Coming back to this. So what do we do? So English not being a phonetic language, which means that something that is spoken can be written in two or three or four different ways. So the learner has to understand how to write that. And the other way around, when you're reading it, what sound would go there in the word? Take the first letter, A for example. A for able. A sound. A for ask, ah. A for apple, ah. A for hard, ah. Oh, as in caught. Five sounds, six sounds. How do you understand? So if someone's learning new, you teach him A for apple. That's where the problem is. You know, you can never teach your child A for apple, B for boy. A for apple, cat instead of card. Bad instead of so apple. Bad instead of so bad. Okay. But what about say around. A lot of people you say no he was around that why because they're taught A for apple so around nahi bowling around bowling so that is where the challenge is so never associate a letter with a sound never teach A for apple when you're teaching the child say A is this letter the sounds it can have are A for apple A for ask A for about A for caught Right? The different sounds to the word. So that is where we need to teach the child the patterns. And that is what is the challenge in spelling. Aapne suna kuch. Abhi uske teen option hai. Multiple choice har ek word mein aa jata hai. Choose one of the following. Kya choose karega bacha? There is where the you have to remember the spelling. Patterns hai, but the exceptions to patterns. So you need to remember the spellings to be effective there. And that is where your memory comes in, right? Coming back to that, there are a lot of patterns, some which help you. I'll just start reading a few rules. I mean, I know them, but if I have to read them, it's a big challenge for me to remember and recite. I'll be sharing the file with you all, so you all can do that. Just a minute. Right. The one of the most common ones is the short vowel rule. Now, first, let's understand a syllable. What's a syllable? Can any of the children tell me? Raina? Come on. Ekansh, can you tell me what's a syllable?
A syllable is the place in the word. Like, not the place, but syllable is where the word breaks into halves.
No. You so break
the syllable, we have to take a pause in the pronunciation.
Not pronounce, but it's pronunciation. Pronunciation, not pronunciation. So pronounce, but pronunciation. Right. Okay. So vowel, a syllable is a unit of sound. Anytime you open your mouth for a word, it's one syllable. For example, any word, let's take a few words here. I've got Ritwik. Ritwik. Two times, that's two syllables. Chitransh, two syllables. Chitransh, two syllables. Ansh, only one syllable. Now, if I look at his surname, Sadavarte, four sounds. My name, Manish, Parik, two in each, right? Pune, Maharashtra, four. India, two. So one unit of sound is called a syllable. So first you need to understand how to break up the word into correct syllables. And that is where words like tuition come in. Tuition has three syllables. In India, mein do hi hote. Tuition. It's actually tuition. So t-u-tu or t-y-u, both acceptable.
What is world universe?
Or tuition. Sorry, bacha?
Sir, world universe.
There's a lot of background noise, which I can't understand what you're saying. Just type it out in the chat box, which I can't understand. Just type it out in the message. So, one very simple rule in English is that in one syllable, there can only be one vowel sound. You can never have two vowel sounds in a syllable. Yes, you can have two letters which merge into one, like the diphthong A, I, OI. Yeah, universe, three. Universe has three syllables. So when you're able to break it up, you know how many vowel sounds there are, and therefore that would help you with spelling, right? So that's one. Plus the rule that there's only one vowel sound helps you with the spelling. Now it's a short word with one syllable, like cat, talk, shift, right, then you can understand that, you know, where the spelling would be. So r-i-t, right. So that could help you with that. So r, you know that r could be just r, or it could be w-r at times when the w is silent. So right. So that's how you find out. That also helps with the jumbled words. When you've got the letters mixed up and it's a short word, you know that the vowel has to be in the center. So then with the remaining words, you can jumble around, try to make group. Just say W-R-I-T-E is, you know, mixed up. There's two vowel letters there, but the last E is silent. So maybe, you know, I-E can go together, but then you've got W, T, and R. So T-W is a cluster. So T-U-W-I-R-E, twire, main word hai. So then W-R is a cluster. So W-R-I-T-E, right. So that helps you with certain words. Shorter words, it's quite easy. Scum, S-C-U-M. So, you know, U is in the center. So, S, M, and C, which goes together? M and C may not. SM can go together and S, SK can go together. So, SMUCK doesn't make sense. So, SCUM or M-U-C, SMUCKS, no, doesn't make sense. So, if you play around, it becomes easier with your task of unjumbling letters also. So, that's the first rule, that the vowel is in, usually in the center and two consonants around it, if it's single syllable word, right? Again, when two vowels go together, this has been taught in school to the children. When two vowels are written, there's two options. One is that the second vowel becomes silent and the sound is taken out of the first vowel. Or it becomes a diphthong. It changes, right? So children, can you give me an example of this where two vowels go together and the first is sounded and the second is silent? Like meet, M-E-E-T or M-E-A-T? the first E is sounded, the second is second vowel is not. Seat, please, P-L-E-A-S-E-E is sounded, A is silent, please. And the sound becomes that of the letter, the name of the
30.
Letter. Yeah. And then you got diphthongs like O, ow, as in B-R-O-W-N, ow, O-U, O-W becomes ow.
Sir, guess.
Sorry?
Guess.
Yes, G-U-E-S-S, so you, guess. Actually, that's, it becomes a short sound. That's one of the exceptions, sir. Eh, it's a short sound, guess. It's the schwa sound. It's the shortest sound in English. So there, U, E, both are not spoken. It's the short schwa sound as in bet, guess. Sorry, that's not the schwa sound. It's the E sound as in bet, guess, said, E sound. The letter E, short E sound, eh. Right. So again, those are the exceptions. That is what I said. You know, it's confusing. But again, it comes back to memory there. So that's one. Then the Y. The Y as a long I, when is it a E sound and when is it is a I sound? Can someone tell me? When is I and when it is I? When is Y pronounced as an I and when is it pronounced as an I? I, come on, Y as an I. So, Ritwik, whose T-shirt are you wearing? Ritwik, whose T-shirt are you wearing?
I.
Hey, sir.
Whose T-shirt are you wearing?
Whose? It's mine T-shirt.
My. See? My. M-Y. My. The Y is an I sound. My. Try. Fly. Spy. Fly. Tie. The T-I-E tie is the E sound there, but T. I fly. By. Spy. I sound. So the I sound there. And why is it I sound there? When there's no other vowel sound and if the Y is at the end, C-C-R-Y, there's no vowel sound. The Y takes the vowel sound, F-L-Y, S-P-Y. Then it takes the I sound. There's no other vowel in the word. Right? But if there is another vowel and the Y is at the end, then becomes an E sound. Funny, bonny, honey, money. Right? E sound. Now, don't worry, children. I'm going to send this file to everybody so you all can read that at home. Don't worry about trying to remember right now. You'll get the file. So try and just understand the patterns, yeah? Then when do I use O-I or O-Y? What's the difference? When do I say O-I as an O-I sound and O-Y as an O-I sound? Come on, boy. Tell me. Ekansh. Come on. I gave her a clue. O-Y. O-I.
Oil. Boy and soil.
Soil. So, bacha, O-I. When do I use O-I and O-Y? Now,
sir,
when the word is at the end.
Sir, soil.
The sound is at
soil.
The, yeah, soil. But
soil
that is O-I.
Soil. And boy is the O-Y.
Soil.
Okay. Now, listen. If it's at the end, boil. It is O-Y. If it is in the middle, it is O-I. Compare boil, B-O-I-L. Soil, toil,
spoil,
oil. Coin, right?
Boy.
It's in the middle, so it's O-I.
Boy,
it's
toy.
End, it's O-I. Boy.
The boy. Toy.
Toy. Toy. Very good.
Boy, O-I is little longer and O-Y little short.
Oil, no, but it's the same sound. Toil. Boy. It's the same sound. There's no difference in the sound, right? Okay. Then next you have the double consonants. When do you use double consonants? So the letters B, D, B for Bravo, D for Delta, G for guest or gamma, M for mother, N for November, and P for Papa, right? These letters are doubled when it's a very short word with two syllables, right? As in, come on, give me examples. See, rabbit, hobbit. Hobbit, then so B is in the middle, so it has two letters, R-O-H-O-B-B-I-T, robber, R-O-B-B-E-R,
right? Riddle,
F-L-A-P-P-E-R, flapper, flipper, manner,
riddle,
sorry,
riddle,
riddle, very good, come on, more words,
ripple,
ripple, wow, what do I use to hit someone like that, what is that? Dagger, D-A-G-G-E-R, the small knife, dagger. Then?
Rubber.
Come on, musicians. What do you play like this?
Apple.
Drummer, drummer.
Apple, drummer. Very good. The person who plays the drum, drummer, D-R-U-M-M-E-R.
Rapper.
Rapper. You sing rap, right? How many of you rap?
Potter.
Copper, very good. Copper.
Super.
Sorry? Bottle. Water. Very nice. Superb. So you know that rule, right? Then the CH sound. The CH sound can be either CH or TCH. So when do I use CH and when do I use TCH in this correct? Can someone tell me? When it's in the middle or at the start, you say CH. When it's towards the end, it's the last sound, then you say TCH. As in watch,
chapter.
Hatch, hatch, match, latch, TCH at the end. Champion, cheese.
Sir, hatch. Hatch or pitch? Pitch.
Sorry? Pitch. Hatch. Yeah, pitch. So that pitch is one of the exceptions. CH,
sir,
pitch.
Sir, hatch.
Hatch. Right? P-I-T-C-H, pitch. H-A-T-C-H.
Match. Hatch.
Very good. CH at the start or middle. Bunch is one of the exceptions. Huh? It's not B-U-N-T-C-H, B-U-N-C-H. Huh? Be careful, bacha. It's not always the rule, but generally that is the rule. So B-U-N-C-H, bunch.
Sir, techno.
Bunch, right? Then we've all learned about the magic.
Lunch.
Yeah, lunch, L-U-N-C-H. So it's one of the few exceptions, not always T-C-H, right? So you have to be careful. Now the magic E, the E at the end changes the sound. You all have learned that, right? Mad becomes made, right? Give me other words like that. Did, hide. Come on. Then other words.
Pet,
peat. Can, cane. Man, main. Ban, bane. Tan. Hat, hate. Fat, fate. So all the letters. A, E, I, U.
Bad.
Yeah. Shin becomes sign. Sin becomes flat. Sign. Tin, shine. Bine. Tin, tine. Right? Pin, pine, for the letter E, met, M-E-T-E, pet, peat, meat, peat, right? And then letter O, hop becomes hope, cop becomes cope, top becomes tope,
sir.
What becomes rote, right?
Sir, it can be poison. Poison.
Sorry?
Poison.
What is poison?
Sir, it is an English word.
Yeah, but how does it apply to this rule, bacha? Yeah, very good.
It is,
but is not a word, bacha. Min is not a word. Min, mine, yes, but min is not a word. Bin, bind, but again, bind is not a word. Tin, tine, sin, sign. Yeah, fin and fine. The fin of a fish and fine. Right? Then another problem sound. Silent letters. How many of you are comfortable with the silent letters? I don't like children.
Sir, grim, grime. Huh? Sir, grim, grime.
Grim, grime. Yeah, okay. Now, silent letters. WR cluster the W is silent, write, W-R-I-T-E, write, W-R-I-S-T, wrist, wrote, rest, wrong, wrestle, wrinkle, right? The W is silent. Again, K-N, the K is silent. No, knowledge, new, knit,
right?
Yes. Sorry, bacha.
Sir, it.
I can't understand, bacha.
Sir, I'm typing in the chat.
Okay, so there's a lot of disturbance. I can't hear you all. Okay, now the H, the letter H is sometimes silent at the start of words like honor, honest. Eight, very good. The eight, E I and G H is silent. It's a ter sound, right? Eight. So the H is silent at the start. Honor, hour, honesty, air, right? It's silent at the start. Sometimes when in the ch group, ch, it becomes silent. Mechanic, M-E-C-H, becomes mechanic. Very good. Might, M-I-T, the H is silent. So ch, the H is silent as in mechanic, chorus, right? Chemistry, technology, stomach, school, the H is silent. Now, again, W-H, the H is silent. All the questioning words, which, when, why, right? Now be careful. There's some words where the W is silent. Who, whose, whom. The W is silent there. W-H means W is silent there.
How?
Who, whom, whom. Otherwise the H is silent. Very fun, no? Which, what. Right. Just a minute, children.
Who's?
Yeah, who's W silent, H is sound, no? Who, who's? So have to be careful. Sometimes the W is silent, sometimes the H is silent. Very funny in English. Yeah. Again, how would you pronounce this word? Let me just write this word for you. I don't want to say it.
It is very confusing in the silent word.
How do you pronounce this word? E-X-A-M-P-L-E.
Example. Example.
Okay. Listen to the word. Listen to the word. It is
Example.
That is how it's pronounced. Example.
Yes, sir.
And it is exhibit.
Exhibit.
Exhibit. Exhibit. The H is L. Exhibit. Right. So the EX sound has three. The EX letters have three sounds. It is I, G, Z, IGS, X, and IX. IX, X, and right. So again, you have to remember which of the sound it is. Now here the H becomes silent sometimes. Now G is silent in the GN group. At the start and at the end, GNOME is pronounced as gnome. Yeah. Assign, resign, campaign, benign, align at the end of the word. At the start, GNU is not GNU, is not GNU, it's NU. NU, NU, it's pronounced NU, right? Then you have NOM and you have NAW, GNAW.
Yes, sir.
The dog chewing the bone is NAW. It's not GNAW, it's NAW, NAW the bone, right? Now the P is silent. If you've seen that movie, Chupke Chupke, very funny. In that, the hero asks, TO2 hai, DO2 hai, to GO GU kyu nahi hai? Like, why is Gio go? So English is funny, right? So then he says, PSY, psychology, kyu nahi? Now the P is silent there. So it's not psychology, it's psychology, physiology, psychiatrist, psychic, right? Pneumatic, pneumonia. The P is silent there, right? Now a few other lists there. I can go on, bacha. I'll bore you. I'm not going to take time reading that. There are a lot of these rules you're aware of. I'm going to send you the file with a lot of these words, especially the...
Sir, can you tell some books which we can read?
Huh, books. I've already shared a book list. How many of you downloaded that book list, children? I shared that last month, I guess.
Sir, I did not get it, I think.
Okay, so I'll just share that again. Please download it because...
Sir, I also didn't retrieve it.
Download it as soon as I share it because otherwise it gets lost in the message. Huh? And today I've sent a few comic books. Please download them. You'll need a comic book reader to read them. I've sent the name of the one that I read, which is Comic Rack. That's a very good comic book reader. You can read that, right? Yes, so there are a few more words, especially, you know, the word, there's one very confusing word list, which is, one minute, let me just write that down for you. How do you pronounce this group? O-U-G-H. So let me tell you that there are six pronunciations to this word group. Can you beat that, children? Four letters, but six pronunciation. Gabbar Singh bole the na, ye bahut na insafi hai. Char letter aur six sound. So how is it? It's O, as in do, though, although. Second one is U, as in through, throughout. The third one is off, as in
cough.
This is not cough. Huh? In India, we say cough, but that is wrong. It's cough. O-F-F, off, cough. It's pronounced like cough, right? There's a third sound, right? Then you have aw, as in bot, frots, forts. Then you have ow, like bow, or B-O-U-G-H, bow of a tree, right? And then the last one is uff, as in tough, rough, enough. So this group has six different pronunciations. You have to be careful, right? So I've written the rules and examples of that in the file. You all can read that. Now, very important. Suffix and prefix. What do I mean by suffix and what is a prefix? I explained to you, right? Suffix is something at the end. Now, when the word becomes longer, by adding a suffix, the pronunciation changes. It also changes in compound nouns. When you join two nouns together, the pronunciation changes. How do you say the word P-O-S-T-M-A-N?
Postman.
Postman. Remember, it's not... When you add the word man to another noun, the noun word, the vowel sound becomes shorter. That's called vowel reduction. So it's postman, milkman, salesman, not salesman, postman, milkman, right? Same thing with the word land. When you add land to another word, it doesn't remain land. The pronunciation becomes lund. So it's not England, Holland, Scotland. It's England, Holland, Scotland, Ireland, Iceland, right? Okay. So it doesn't change there. So when the word becomes longer, like you add the word photo.
England, Scotland.
All of them, ma'am. England, Scotland, Ireland, Holland. It's not Holland, England, Scotland. It's Ireland, Scotland, Holland, Iceland.
Language,
right. Okay. So another very commonly mispronounced word.
Irish.
Right. So another very commonly mispronounced word in India is the word photo. Who clicks photos? Photographer, not photographer. The correct pronunciation is photographer. Choreographer. Philosopher, not philosopher, not philosophy. It's philosophy. So photograph, graph, long sound. But when you make it longer, photograph becomes photography. Right? Philosophy. So safi, graphy are suffixes. The sound before that is stressed, which becomes longer. And the sound in the suffix becomes shorter. So graph, but graphy. Photograph, photography. Philosophy, geography. That's how you pronounce the words, right? A lot of fun in learning all this. I used to enjoy that when I learned it. A lot of fun because every time you make the word longer, the word changes. Kabaddi khelta hai word apne saath. Hum hutu tu karke ek baju pakdenge, word dusri baju jaake badal jayega. To hume wapis udhar jaake usko pakadna padta hai. Very funny in English, huh? Maza aata hai baat. Right. So, those are the basic rules. I've given us a few spelling rules also, how to treat the E and the Y, right? So, yeah. So, you can go through the list. I'll be sending that by today or tomorrow in the afternoon. You can go through the list and there's quite a lot of things in that. Any other questions parents have about this?
Manisha, a general question actually. I've seen the spell bee international championship. Mm-hmm. Whenever a word is given to a child, then ask that what's the origin of the word. And the origin of the word actually changes the meaning.
See, that is where you need deeper knowledge because see, there's a concept called homophones where the sounds are similar, right? Like I as in E-Y-E-I and the letter I. So words with the same pronunciation. So if you know the origin, you know the meaning, then you can tell me you can speak the correct spelling. So you can either speak both or three, whatever three words there are, or if you want to be more specific, you can ask them which it is. Plus, when you know the origin, whether it's from Greek language or whether it's from some other language, then as I said, the spelling rules of that language apply. So these are people who've learned, how each language affects the spelling of the word because they've learned foreign language words as a separate list. It's a huge list. I myself, when I teach vocab, I've got more than 400 words in the foreign list. Mm-hmm. I've got a whole list of root words that I teach to children. I've got more than 150 root words that I go through. Each word has at least 3 or 4 words in English. So then they understand the origin, the root of how it comes. For example, the word lux, L-U-X, lux, in Greek means luxury. So that's where the word luxury comes from. Lux, deluxe, luxury. Lum means brightness. So luminous, luminosity, right? So the root word affects the spelling. So that's how. So for example, Achilles, the letter CH in Greek are pronounced as a K, Achilles. So if you know the root language, then you know how to what the pronunciation would be in terms of letters then.
Okay.
Right. For example, if some European languages, the letter J is pronounced as a Y.
Yeah.
Whereas in Spanish, it's pronounced as a H.
Okay.
So it's not Jesus in Spanish, it's Jesus. G-E-S-U-S is pronounced as Jesus in Spanish. And W-I-L-R-I-J-K, which is an area in the city of Belgium. I lived there for some time. I was working there. So the area, if you look at the spelling, it's really difficult. You'd wonder how it's pronounced. It's W-I-L-R-I-J-K. So later on, I realized that the J in their language is pronounced as a vowel sound, as a Y. So the name of the area was Wilrijk.
Okay.
So that's how the, you know, the origin would affect the spelling.
Thanks, sir.
You're welcome. Any other questions? Ansh?
May I ask?
Yes, sir.
So one general question, like to understand what will be your role? I mean, you will be preparing the students for this spell bee only, or you will be, you know, teaching English, or I'm not clear about.
Okay, so let me introduce myself. Sorry, I am like that. I keep forgetting that. I'm Manish Parikh. I have been working for more than 30 years now. I've been teaching for more than 10 or 12 years. I have a center here in Wakad where I teach children English and math. I also have training programs for adults. Now, I've been associated with the school for about 2.5 years now. I generally teach the subject called Global Perspective, which is more about behavior, personal development, broadening of this, you know, the thinking of children, where we sensitize children to the fact that it's okay to be different. People are different. And that is where our skills are. You know, the more different people you meet, the more you learn to look at things from different perspectives, and therefore you are richer by that. Because when you see something from one perspective, you may not be able to understand it. You know, you may face problems in solving it, but you faced a problem and you can approach it from 3 or 4 or 5 different ways. If you look at it from different perspectives, you know, you think like one person, then you think like an Indian, you think like an American, and maybe you think like not, you know, nationality, maybe from a profession, how an accountant thinks, how a salesperson thinks. If you realize that there are different ways of looking at things, and if you look at things differently, maybe you can find the solution. So you get along better in life. It's easier for you to get along with people because then you accept the difference. So GP is about that. It's just about building, you know, the capability in children to be broader minded, to be more accepting, you know, being not having that insecurity. See, it's mainly insecurity that drives people to be intolerant. When I'm not sure of my own beliefs, you know, I will be worried if someone comes to me, my beliefs will change. Well, if something changes for the better, that's not bad. It's good, is it? So it's about trying to get children to that state where they are confident about themselves. They're open to learning new things. They're open to looking at things in different perspectives. That is what GP is essentially about. And that is what I take as a subject there. I'm just a visiting faculty. And because I have a lot of interest in working with children, I do different things. I take workshops at times. Last year, I had a gardening workshop, which is again scheduled this year. I had a workshop where I taught children how to make enzymes from fruit peels. I taught them how to do composting so that, you know, you don't throw out kitchen waste, so you can help save pollution. So if you take out kitchen waste from your garbage, then you got plastic, metal, glass, and, you know, most of the things that can be recycled. So once you take kitchen waste out, you segregate the rest. You become, you know, 90% garbage free. Your garbage goes down to less than 10%. And that 10% is usually biological waste, bandages and diapers and stuff like that. So you can reduce your garbage by 90% just by separating the kitchen waste and composting that at home. So 50% kitchen waste, you recycle, that doesn't go into the waste. The 40% of the rest is what you can recycle, paper, glass, metal, plastic. So, you know, we taught them that. So there are a lot of other things I do. I also teach geometry by folding papers. I had a couple of sessions with the 5th, 6th, 7th graders where I taught them a few steps about how to do geometry with paper folding. So because I have a lot of interests, I work with children with different things. But that is generally what I do. And language, of course, because I teach language. Sometimes when the school needs certain input, I do come into this. For example, with the spell bee right now, I help them out. I have sessions with children for that. So that's where my focus is, maths and English essentially, and the GP year.
Really great to know. You know, in future also you'll be taking classes for preparing for Spell B, right? Or
I'm not sure that the school will decide. I'm definitely associated with the GP and the other extra activities that go on. Like I said, the gardening session is scheduled there for next week or the week after that. So I'll be teaching children how to do gardening at home, how to prepare the soil, how to germinate the seeds and stuff like that. So we'll be doing that. Spell Bee, the school teachers will do because that requires more attention. And I have only so much time because I have my own classes. So I can only spare so much time to work with the school because I also have my own center. So I have a lot of children and I have a lot of adults I work with in training in English. So in the mornings, I'm generally free because most of my programs are after school. So in the morning, I work with the school.
Okay. Yeah, I really like the session and, you know, your Thank teaching you, and your knowledge. Really, I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Yeah, and it's more for me, you know, I enjoy working with children, which is why I left my corporate job and I'm doing this now. Because it's my passion, working with children. So I don't know whether the children enjoy or not, but I definitely enjoy working with children.
So we would like to have more such sessions from you. It is very nice.
Yes, ma'am. You can schedule it. We can work out as per my schedule and we can always have more sessions.
Definitely,
let me know if you need any more sessions. Yeah. I'd like to thank ma'am. You've been with me very patiently sitting there.
No, Shuma.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes. It was interesting. As a parent too, I enjoyed it.
Yeah. I miss Reeta. Reet doesn't interact with me so much now. I think she's still adjusting to the new school. Yeah. She's still adjusting the new school.
Yes.
But nice to see her now more regularly.
Yes, sir.
Right. Thank you, all of you. Thank you, children. Ansh,
thank you, sir.
Ritvik, Ekansh, Ariana, Ranveer, all of you. Riya. Thank you for giving your time.
Sir, we need more classes and we also enjoy learning with you.
Yeah. Thank you, Bacha. That makes my day.
Thank you,
all of you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, parents.
Bye.
Have a good day. Bye.
Bye, all of you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.